If you got your Bibles, turn to a very, very familiar Psalm, Psalm 121, will you? Psalm 121. It is good to be here this morning. Thank God. I want to give you a little advertisement if I can. The last three Sundays, I have been in three different adult Sunday school classes. I've been in the Joy class, the Ambassadors class, and the Home Builders class, the last three Sundays. And I want to say this to you. If you're not going to Sunday school, you are adult. These are three great classes. Three deacons teaching those classes, doing an awesome job. And by the way, it's biblical. The Bible says for a deacon to be apt to teach. And I told Brother Dave today as he spoke on the family, that's probably the boldest lesson I have heard in years from a Sunday school teacher on the family. Dear God, we need it. Somebody say amen. And I was thankful for it. And I want you, hey, if you're a young couple, get in that class. If you're in Brother Jeff's age group, get in that class. If you're a Joy class member, get in this class. It's awesome, and you need to be there. Amen. Stand with your Bibles open today. Let's look at this psalm together. Psalm 121. If you got your Bible, say amen. Well, that was a little weak. One more time. If you got your Bible, say amen. Amen. Thank you. This is what we call a song of degree, or one of the songs of degrees. This is a psalm that the worshipers would sing as they went to Jerusalem to participate in one of the three great annual feasts, the Feast of the Passover, the Feast of Pentecost, and the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, they were pilgrims. By the way, if you read 1 Peter, we are pilgrims. We're on a journey. And let's look at what the psalmist says. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. I'm interested in that a little bit. I found out something about that, and I'll give that to you in just a moment. You underline that. I've never seen that phrase or understood that phrase so much until I did study that out this week. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. I want to speak this morning, just before I pray, I'll give you my text. Who's going to help me? Who's going to help me? You know, a lot of folks today depending on the government to help them. And I'm not against government assistance, but I want to tell you, when it's all said and done, they're going to run out of money one day. And I want to ask you, who's going to help you? A lot of folks depending on people to help them. I want to tell you something. It's good to have friends. Somebody say amen. But a friend can only do so much. Thank God for the one that really can help you. Our Father, right now I pray. These folks came this morning. They made an effort to come. They came to get fed. They came to get some help. They didn't come to get butchered. I'm not going to do that this morning. They came to get some help. I'm glad that we got an old-fashioned King James Bible that we still can give them help out of. I'm glad that it was good enough for, as Brother Dave said 300 years ago, Jonathan Edwards, when he preached that sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. I'm glad that your word is infallible, inerrant. I'm glad that it never fails. And I pray this morning you'll help somebody in it. In Jesus' name, for his sake, amen. You may be seated. Just so you know, I want to share this with you. Verse 1, actually, a lot of people misinterpret verse 1. Verse 1 is not a declaration of hope, but rather it is a cry of despair. The psalmist is not looking for the hills for help. When he said, I lift up mine eyes unto the hills for help, he's not looking for the hills for help. What he's saying is, I'm a pilgrim. I'm getting ready to travel through the mountains. I'm getting ready to travel through the danger. I'm getting ready to travel through those deep places in the hills, and I need some help. And by the way, he wasn't saying the hill gods were going to help him. I want to tell you, there's not a God outside of Jehovah God can give you help this morning. But I can tell you this morning, there is help in him. Thank God for that. Really what he was saying is, there's dangers in them hills. There's something lurking in them hills. Boy, I tell you, I preached a message a few months ago. Jeff kind of reminded me of it last week. Sucker punches of the devil. I want to tell you, the devil's lurking in them hills. The devil's out to seek and to destroy every person, every marriage, every life in this room, starting with this preacher right on down to you. And unless we have God helping us, unless we find real help, he'll be successful. God help us this morning. Who's going to help me? Let me give you three things and I'll let you go home. Verse number 2. I like this. My help cometh from what? Capital O-L, capital O, capital R, capital D. You say, why is that important? Well, that's the word Yahweh. That's a covenant name of God. You know what God's saying in that verse? That name identifies him as a self-existent, eternal, unchanging, who is over it all, who's in control of it all. How many of you been watching all this politics about right now, and you're saying, I'm about half sick of it, and it's not even starting? Somebody raise your hand. And all of them saying they got the answer. Just let me have control of the country. I want you to know we found that. Both up parties have been in control in the last 20 years, and we are a mess. Somebody say amen. I want to tell you, there's only one today can sustain you, help you, and bless you, and his name's mentioned 5 times in this chapter, and his name is Yahweh, or the covenant-making God, the God who's over it all, the God that controls it all, the God that made us with his finger, the God that spake everything in existence. He's the only one who can help you. Let me tell you this. If God can make this world by speaking it into existence, then surely he has power to take care of you. Maybe I didn't get that across. How many of you believe he created everything? You know, it takes a real dumb person to believe in evolution. Hello? You really don't have a lot going for you. There's 4 different brands of evolution they're teaching right now. They say, and you school teachers, get with me, they say that the evolution you're teaching in school right now is obsolete. There's a new one out. Y'all got to adopt it. God help us. I'm glad I can find in the Word of God, let us or make man in our own image. I'm glad I know who created this world. I don't have no debate about it. He's in control of it. He sitteth on the circle of the world. He is over it all. Hallelujah. That's why he's able to do exceedingly abundantly. But if you're able to ask or think, look at verse 3 and 4. Let me go a little further. The scope of your help. Now, the source of your help is God. But look at the scope of your help. In verse 3, look what it says. He will not suffer thy foot to be what? First, he helps those who slip. For the verse tells us the Lord will not allow our foot to slip. How many of y'all found it easy? Or you found it kind of, it's easy to slip. Come on. Now, let me look at you. Every one of you read as much Bible as you supposed to read last week. Hello? It's easy to slip. You say, "Ah, man, I won't slip in sin." It's easy to slip. I won't slip into discouragement. It's easy to slip. I won't get disappointed. It's easy to slip. I won't get distracted. It's easy to slip. And the only thing can keep you from slipping is that you got a God who says, "I won't let your foot to slip." Hey, you think you're going to hold it on? You think your mentality and you can manipulate things and you're able to take care of yourself? You won't make it 24 hours without God. Man, I like this. Verse 5, he said he's like a shadow. The word means a keeper. We're told the Lord will preserve in verse 7 and 8. And then it also means to watch, to keep, to observe, to guard, to have charge of. Boy, thank God. You say, who's helping you? Who's looking over you? One that helps you keep you from slipping. I want to tell you something. There's a lot of people, they've started off in church, but they're not in church any longer. Come on, help me. A boy, he said it in Sunday school. Lord, I have mercy. You give them statistics today. I wrote every one of them down. He was talking about marriages that's falling and slipping. What happened to them? They got their eyes off of God. Somebody say amen. It wasn't because they weren't good people. It wasn't because they didn't have a love for God. It's because they slipped. It's because they quit doing the things they used to do, and that's looking to God and praying and trusting God and leaning on Him. In verse 3 and 4, y'all with me? He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. He helps those that are asleep. I want to tell you what. You want really labels this generation? Let's tell the truth about it. There's so much apathy. There is. And if we King James people, if we independent fundamental people get up and take a stand for what's right today in the political arena and the world arena, you know what they call us? A bunch of redneck heretics that don't have enough sense to come in out of the rain. But somebody needs to wake up, because the majority of the people today are asleep. But I am thankful for something. He helps those that are asleep. Back in World War II, when the Germans were bombing London all night, every night, terrible attack. There was rubble everywhere. There was a lady. Her name was Mrs. Smith. They searched everywhere for her, and finally someone found her in her bedroom, asleep. They were shocked and asked her, said, "Mrs. Smith, how could you sleep with all those bombs dropping all around?" Her answer is priceless. Well, the Bible says, "He that keepeth Israel never slumbers nor sleeps." I'm glad he's on the job 24/7. I'm glad when the devil oppresses me and afflicts me and comes against me, I'm glad he's not sleeping. I'm glad he's at the wheel. I'm glad he's on the throne. I'm glad he's high lifted up. Somebody help me right there. Verse 5 and 6, not only does he help those that sleep, but he helps those that struggle. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. You say, preacher, I never struggle. I never struggle spiritually. You never lie either, do you? We all struggle. Brother Dave was being a little transparent in his lesson today. He made the statement that he struggles sometimes being the kind of leader he should be. Well, you better not forget that, because we all struggle. And outside of God's help, where are we going to be? Somebody help me preach right there. Verse 5 said, he protects us from our enemies. It said, the Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is a shade upon thy right hand. He keeps us from our enemies. Hey, by the way, God took care of Elijah. God took care of Moses. God took care of Abraham. And he is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The same God that took care of them will take care of you. Not only this, look at this. Verse 6, he protects you from the elements. Look what it says. I was reading, this is where I really got stuck in this chapter. The sun shall not smite thee by day. There's two things that's mentioned in this chapter. First of all, sunstroke. That's about physical. Hey, by the way, there ain't nobody can touch your body like God. I'm glad I got a God that can still touch bodies. Amen. She mentioned in that song about healing my broken body. I'm glad I got a God that can even still touch your body. Amen. When the physical infirmities hit you, and by the way, they are going to hit you. I'm glad. Somebody said, by the way, my father-in-law, he's known for this statement. He said, you ain't no sissy going to get old. When you get old, it ain't for sissy. Somebody say amen right there. It ain't. I'm fine. No, I know. You're going to remind me I'm 1 year older than you right at this moment. But look at this next phrase. Had you ever seen it? I understood the first part. The sun that shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. Well, I did a little study. Aubrey, I've done a little study. There's such a thing as sunstroke, but did y'all know there's such a thing as moonstroke? I didn't know it either. I had never heard of it. The ancients believed that moonstroke, and like sunstroke, did not affect the body. It affected mind. And by the way, I found a little truth to that. How many of you find out that during the day you do fine? Amen. Come on. During the day you do fine. When you're up and active, you're doing fine. But ask everybody that's ever went through anything. It's the nighttime that gets you. It's that moonstroke. It's that mind. And I really believe right now, like Tim LaHaye wrote in his book, there is a battle for the mind right now. The devil is out after your mind. I do not believe the devil can possess a Christian. I do not believe a devil can do that. When God came in, hey, he's in. But I do believe that the devil can oppress a Christian. Amen. I believe a devil can make you feel so down. Somebody help me preach right there. He can whoop up on you and affect your mind and make everything black and make you feel like there ain't no hope. You say, what is that? That's moonstroke. You ever heard that phrase, Paul? No, the moon by night. You ever heard a day? I never thought about it. But it's those seasons, Chad, when the devil comes like a roaring lion and he looks at it and gets in your mind and defeat and devastation and despair comes. When does it come? It comes at the nighttime. It comes in the dark times of your life. It comes when you're walking through the valley of the shadow. But I'm glad that God said, I'm your helper. Whew. Glory. Man, I like that. Number three. Finally, verse 7 and 8, the strength of your help. The strength of your help. Verse 7 said, the Lord shall preserve thee from evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The psalmist says that that God will preserve from evil. That refers to both the evil that exists within and the evil that surrounds us. And but I want to tell you what. I was reading in Romans this week. How many, you know, I hear people, they quote this verse and they do it improperly. If any man be in Christ, he new creature, all things pass away, behold, all things new, as if everything's new. Hold a minute. I am new on the inside. But I want all y'all to know something. I still got something hanging on me called the flesh. Somebody help me preach, and you do too. And the flesh is weak, and the flesh, by the way, Paul said in Romans 7, whatsoever dwelleth in the flesh is no good thing. We got two natures. Get up here, Chad. Come up here, Zach. Get over here. Now hold that. Hold that. Take off. Take off. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You better jerk a little bit harder. Hold on. Now you may. That's a real funny little thing, isn't it? But can I tell you? I'll let him be the devil. And he's the Lord. And there's always a struggle. Come on, help me. There's always a struggle. And I need somebody to help me. See, getting saved doesn't mean you get rid of this old nature. Man, there's a lot of folks, they preach this sinless holiness. You know, some of these Armenians, they preach sinless holiness. You know, they're saved every, you know, they get lost in the summer when they wear their bikinis and they get saved in the fall. You know, you're like, amen. I could have went all day without saying that. But they get lost in the summer in their activity, and then they get saved. Saved to lost, saved to lost. By the way, I only believe you get saved once. And I believe this one seals us to the day of redemption. There ain't nothing going to get in to unseal me. Somebody say amen. We say forever. We're preserved from evil. I believe in the perseverance of the saints. Somebody say, I don't believe that. I do. I was depraved, but now I'm saved. You say, what happened? Jesus sealed me to the day of redemption. Look at verse 8. Whew. I'm liking these verses. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even for how long? Now, he's going to preserve my path, whether I'm going in or whether I'm going out. I'm going to ask you a few questions. I'm done. Who's going to help you? Who's going to help you when gas, groceries, and our expenses keep rising while incomes keep going down? Who's going to help you when temptations arise in your heart? Who's going to help you when Satan launches an attack against your life? Who's going to help you when troubles, trials, and problems overwhelm your heart, mind, and soul? Who's going to help you when the bottom falls out of life and you see nowhere to turn? Who's going to help you when friends, family, and other resources fail? Who's going to help you when you don't even know how to help yourself? I'm glad the Bible says, my help cometh from the Lord. I heard a story, and I'll finish with it. How many of you have ever been, when you was younger, I know you wouldn't do this when you was older. How many ever walked on ice when you was younger? Tried the ice out. Come on, raise your hand. Anybody? What'd you do when you went out there to get ready to go? What'd you do? You went out and you checked it out, didn't you? There's a story about a man who did that same thing. He got down and he got on the tip of the ice and he felt it. And he kept, and by the way, it was a long way across the other side. He went all the way across, just feeling around on his hands and knees. Got over on the other side, just about to the end. And all of a sudden, he heard the awful sound he ever heard in his life. It was 8 Clydesdales and a wagon coming across the ice. And he looked. You got the point? I want to tell you, our help coming from the Lord. Some of us are just kind of scared half to death, just kind of feeling ourselves along. Come on, am I right? When God wants us to get up in the buggy in the Clydesdales and take off across the ice because he's able to control and help you. Somebody say amen. Bow your head with me. My help cometh from the Lord.